then you show them the path that leads to your home.
Presentation.
Now, we're going to start with the feet again. Oh, yes, you're in the feet, you're in a running pattern. So you step four times, running forward. Like this. Go ahead and try it with this. One, two, three, four. Good. Again. One, two, three, and four. Excellent. Now, your arms are similar to the first movement, except for your palms are facing your body. Then you extend your arms out.
All right. So it's getting close to 12. Are we ready on you all's end, or y'all need a few more minutes?
Big circle, bring it back into your side.
Yeah, I was saying, it's getting close. Are you all ready to start streaming at 12?
Ready?
Okay.
One, two, three, four. Again, here we go. One, two, three, and four. Awesome. So now let's put those two parts together. So we're going to run.
All right. Test, test. One, two, one, two.
Ready? Here we
go.
One, two, three,
okay.
And
good.
Four.
One more all time. Right.
One, two, three, and four. Nice. So the second
all
part
right.
of that movement is
test, test. One, two, one, two. All right. I think we are good. We will give folks a minute or so to come on in. So we are grateful for your presence today. All right, it is 12 noon here on Saturday in Douglasville, and so it is time to say good afternoon, beautiful people. Grace and peace to each of you who are on campus and those who are online as we start Black History Month here at Golden Memorial United Methodist Church. We are so glad that you are here as we get to celebrate our stories and to celebrate our history at the beginning of this new year and the beginning of Black History Month. You all ready? We excited? All right, all right. So for those who are here, those who are online, again, we welcome you. I think everybody who's on campus knows where everything is. I had a note around housekeeping, so I think we all know where the restrooms are. And we are so glad for your presence today. If you're online, again, that we pray that you are just nestled in wherever you are across the city, across the community, across the region, because we're going to have a great time celebrating stories and sharing together. We can look out as well for any content, any comments that you have online. We'll be checking out for that too, if possible. All right. So with that, we're going to get started with the word of prayer. Hey, come on in, come on in, come on in. And then we will get straight into our first talk in our setup for the month. So let's get started with the word of prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this day. It's a day that you've made. We find our joy and our gladness in you and in it. And we are so grateful, God, for the gift of this new day and the gift of this new month. God, we give you thanks for the gift of this season of celebration in Black History Month. God, for the opportunity to celebrate our stories and to God to celebrate your goodness in the midst of the stories and the culture and the times to which you have called us. So God, we just ask that this time be filled with your Holy Spirit, that we may do your will, that our conversation, our talking, our questions, our sharing, God, may be edifying as your word says we are to build each other up, so that we can be who you called us to be and do what you called us to do. All these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus, who is our Christ. Amen. 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 All right. We are going to go to our slides today. Shout out to our sound team and everyone who was set up from our Black History. I'll give them a shout and our team as well. So to Sean and Fred, we're grateful for you. Let's celebrate them. Our Black History team at the church has done a wonderful job preparing Pastor Deborah, Tabria Cobb, and Uriah Langley. Let's thank them as well. We are so grateful for them. And certainly we'll lift up my beloved, and she has a talk to share her own. But we are so grateful again for your presence. So with that, welcome again to Black History Month at Golden. Next slide. As we start the month, we are on Saturdays from 12 to 1 o'clock each Saturday of the month going to be participating in what we're calling celebration talks, okay? And those are going to be conversations with church and community where we lift up the best of who we are, that we celebrate the best of our stories. And there is a scripture that I want to lift up before I get into my specific talk that will set us up for the month and our conversation together. It comes from the book of Isaiah 51, verse 1 to 2. Isaiah 51, 1 to 2. I'll read it now for us. Isaiah, speaking to Israel, says, "Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many." And here's what's going on in this story, that Isaiah is speaking to Israel, God's people, as a community, as a nation, in the midst of their need for restoration. And what Isaiah is doing is inviting Israel to look back at their forefather and their foremother in Abraham and in Sarah. Because Isaiah recognizes that if Israel can get a glimpse of who their foremother and forefather are, they have access to a gold mine, to a quarry from which they can draw abundance for their life, for their faith in the midst of their challenge. In other words, going back to the stories of those who came before us is like going down into a mine that you can dig from in an unceasing way. Those stories are a place of gold, which is why I have gold up here, that you can keep drawing from. You can draw inspiration, you can draw hope, you can draw life, you can draw strength from the stories of those who came before us. And that is the focus of our celebration talks in 2024, beloved. Because we recognize the power of our stories as a mine that we can draw from. And it makes me realize, and I've learned even more, beloved, that there is power in the stories that we tell, and there is especially power in the stories that we tell ourselves about ourselves, right? Because all of us are telling ourselves stories to ourselves about ourselves. So we have to make sure that the stories that we're telling to ourselves about ourselves are positive stories, they're edifying stories, and they are stories that lift us up and not tear us down, all right? So that is the theme of these celebration talks. Each week we gather, we're going to have time for about a 30-minute or so conversation presentation from these topics that I lay out. We'll have a time for a panel and question and conversation. And then for the first couple of weeks, we're going to have time for, we're going to break bread over some traditional Black Africana dishes. Sound good? That will be the format of our time together each week. Welcome those who are coming online, those who are coming on campus. So here's a preview of the month ahead each Saturday for our celebration talks from 12 to 1 on Saturday afternoons. Today, we're going to start by presentations from our West and North African stories that I'll be presenting for us. Next week, we're going to hear from a Caribbean story by our own Angelica Harper King. The third week, we're going to be lifting up the African-American stories of Douglasville by our own Tabria Cobb. And she's also got a panel of several of our elected officials that you're not going to want to miss that experience. And lastly, to close out with a bang, we're going to be on the fourth Saturday of the month celebrating the African-American presence in the founding of Douglas County. Notice how I spelled Douglas, because there is some groundbreaking inspiration and information that you're going to hear from our own chair of the Douglas County Board of Education, Madam Tracy Rookert, that is going to inspire you and blow your mind. So please do invite people out every Saturday of the month for celebration talks. Tell family, tell a friend, tell your neighbor to be inspired, to be equipped, and to build rich multi-ethnic community together. Sound good? Any questions for those who are here and online? That mic is available if we need it once we're ready for them. All right? All right, so with that, we're going to go ahead and get started. Next slide, please, to our first celebration talk today that I am so honored to share. And today's celebration talk is a story from West and North Africa by yours truly. All right. Also, as we're getting started, you may notice that I am wearing two pieces of garb. You are welcome to wear throughout the course of the month on Saturdays and Sundays, traditional Africana or black inspired garb. I have on a West African dashiki, and this is a North African or Middle Eastern kufiya. It is a scarf. Okay. So you are welcome to wear that or not, but we want you to know you're welcome to do so throughout the month. All right, so the talk that I'm going to offer today lifts up in specific two countries that you'll see on the screen there. One is the country of Nigeria in West Africa, and the North African country is the country of Egypt. All right, anybody heard of those countries before? Okay, a couple people. If not, don't worry. You're going to get a great intro today. All right, next slide. Let's get into it. Today, a West African story that I'm going to lift up starts in Tennessee. All right? If you look on the page there, that young man that is right next to the tall guy, the shortest one on there, that's me when I was about 12 years old. That's me in Nashville, Tennessee. That is my hometown. I love my hometown in Tennessee. And Nashville is rich for a variety of reasons, but one of the things that makes it special is that it has a consortium of historically African-American colleges and universities there. Tennessee State University, Meharry Medical College, where I was born, as well as Fisk University, where I was pictured in that photo. Fisk University, one of the first HBCUs in the South, started immediately after the Civil War in 1865, had, when I was growing up, a summer camp called Fisk University Mini College, okay? And that experience was a six-week experience during the summers in which kids from all over the Nashville, Middle Tennessee area could come and learn, come and grow, and come and be enriched culturally and have a good time. So during my time there, one of the things that we had as an activity was that we had a West African dance troupe. If you were here before we got started, you saw a video of them that would come and teach us West African dance, drumming, and attire and culture. It was an amazing experience, and you'll hear more about that shortly. But one of the things that we learned while we were there was the place that five countries that are traditional West African ancestors had hailed from. Now, this was very empowering as a child, right? Because I started out in this camp when I was 6 years old. So I was hearing about some of the places that some of my ancestral West African folks had come from. And it was really amazing. And we would do our drumming, and we would do our dancing, and we would sing Funga, Alafia, Ashe, Ashe. We learned traditional songs and dance. And we also learned, like I said, the places of the ancestors. So every day, or every time we gathered, I think it was like Tuesdays, Thursdays, we had to remember that our West African ancestors came from these five countries, predominantly Mali, Guinea, Gambia, Senegal, and Ivory Coast. So we learned those countries. And so for me, it was so empowering because I had a sense of peace about this. Because for me, it helped me to know that African Americans have ancestral places of favor and accomplishment. That the peoples that we come from were not started in bondage, but they started in greatness. They started in great civilizations. They were builders of kingdoms. They were people who had culture. That was the root of where our people had come from. All right. Now, looking up recently through Ancestry.com on my mother's side of the family, I got to know some of these specific places for our family. And I saw that my ancient ancestry on the African end came from Mali and from Nigeria. Those are the two flags that are on the left side of your screen there. Mali is the first one, the green, yellow, and red. And Nigeria, which we're going to talk about today, is the green, white, and green. Okay? Also found out that my folks who are from Alabama, Tennessee, also had folks that were connected to Ireland on the East African end. All right? So we got folks from kind of all over there. So we are going to talk about, in the West African story today, of the country of Nigeria. Somebody say Nigeria. Next slide, please. Here's some information around Nigeria. To start, we need to understand that the country of modern Nigeria is actually a combination of several different West African kingdoms, all right, including the Kingdom of Benin and the oil kingdom that comes from Yoruba Kingdom. One of the things that you'll find and the things that I discovered is that in West Africa and other parts of Africa, kingdoms are among tribal leaders. So you can have a lot of different kingdoms in different areas. It's not like the British monarchy or Western monarchies. You can have kingdoms and the kingdom can be a village, okay? So that was is how modern Nigeria is composed of. Now, what I'm going to talk about to start is the Kingdom of Benin. Okay, this kingdom was a kingdom that existed for 600 years in what is now southern Nigeria, from the 1200s to the 1800s. The bas relief sculpture that you see on the top is from the Kingdom of Benin. Okay, now the Kingdom of Benin, that kingdom was ruled by Obas, and they were known as kings. They were the people who led. They engaged in government. They engaged in trade. They also kind of had a mystical sense of who they were in their leadership. All right. Now, what made the Kingdom of Benin great is that they were very successful in commerce. They were successful in trade. They were successful in artwork. They traded with gold, ivory, and peppers. They also were great workers in art and also were great sculptors. So that, again, that's a sculpture that you'll see there from the Kingdom of Benin. Okay. They had challenges like just every other culture and country did, but these were some great works that they did, okay? On the bottom there, you're going to see a photo from one of the oil kingdom, from the Yoruba kingdoms. Now, to keep in mind, when we're talking about Nigeria and a lot of parts of Africa, African cultures are tribal, like everybody's tribal, but African cultures are very tribal. So that means even within a country, it's not just one ethnic group of people, like here in the United States. It's multiple groups of people, even multiple African tribes in a country. So you'll hear me reference three different tribes that you'll see on the next slide throughout the course, but I just want you to get that in mind. It's not just one group of people, because if you hear a popular American culture sometimes, depending on who it is, talk about Africa, people may think that the continent is just one country. It's not. It's many different countries, many different cultures, many different peoples that have many different languages, complexions. It's diverse as anybody else is, okay? So in Nigeria, these three tribes, next slides please, that you'll see lifted up, I've named here. The Hausa, the Yoruba, and the Igbo tribes, okay? The Hausa, the Yoruba, and the Igbo tribes. Those are the predominant overarching ethnic tribes in Nigeria, okay? And they, just like any other tribes, and even the tribes that you would find in the Bible from the nation of Israel, got into disagreements and got into fights, okay? And so during the 19th and 20th centuries, there were divisions between these groups of people. And just like any family, and a tribe is really a family of families, when there are divisions, that weakens the tribe. Jesus says that a house that is divided cannot stand, right? It's going to fall. That's what happened in a lot of West African countries. And so what happened in that season is that actually made way for the invasion of British colonial rule. Okay, that's how Western British colonial rule came about. And it was challenging because there were these invasions. That's where actually the West African slave trade originated. And it should be named that it wasn't all on the Europeans, that West African tribal leaders were responsible for participating in it. And so it's always greed. That's the root of all evil. It's not just belong to one group of people. Greed is always the root of evil. And so that all of that greed, that division made way for this colonial rule. OK, now there was resistance. And so modern Nigeria is really defined by that resistance and independence. So after decades of resisting, Nigeria's independence movement came about in the 50s and 60s. Now, if that time period sounds familiar, it should, because if you look across the Atlantic here, the United States, that's the same season in the 50s and 60s that the civil rights was going on, right? And we know that the black church had a big, big role in the civil rights movement in our country. Well, in 1960, Nigeria finally became self-ruled. They became their own independent country. They are currently constituted as a republic, okay? So with that, let's go on, next slide, to Nigerian culture and diasporan culture today. Let me give you the name of the current Nigerian president. His name is Bola Ahmed Tinubu. Bola Ahmed Tinubu. Again, Nigeria is a republic. It is a republic. We are a democracy here with republic ideals, but Nigeria is a republic. So a little bit about Nigerian culture today. This is where I think we'll all find some connections around Nigerian culture and diasporan culture. Now, when I say diasporan, here is what I mean by that. The diaspora is when a people have been dispersed and exist in their own cultural way across different countries or continents, okay? That's what I refer to when I say black or Africana diaspora. Right, that black African people have been dispersed, not just in Africa, but in the Caribbean and throughout the Americas, right? And we are black, Africana, wherever we are. That's one of the other things that we hope that you'll take away from these celebration talks, is recognizing there are many wonderful ways and expressions of what it means to be Africana or to be black. It's not just one thing. There's ways that we are in America, there's ways we are in Africa, and even within our countries. And so with that, I want to say parenthetically that all of us need to be encouraged to express and be who God made you to be. You can't afford to live your life trying to worship somebody else's opinions. You need to be who God says you are. And whatever that looks like is what God says you need to be. Are you with me? All right. So with that, we have diaspora Nigerian culture throughout, okay? Again, there are those three cultures that are expressed that I named from the tribes of Nigeria, the Hausa, the Yoruba, and the Igbo, all right? Again, we shared already that modern Nigerian culture is comprised of many different subcultures, hundreds of languages, y'all, because again, you have to think about the fact that most African countries are composed of different cultures that have different villages, and your tribe has to figure out how to talk with my tribe, has to talk with the tribe across the street, has to talk with the tribe down the way, right? So it's all these different groups. Now, some of the pictures and the culture. Some of the food that crossed the Atlantic into our diasporan life here. Raise your hand if you recognize any of these food. Plantains. Anybody heard of like plantains? All right. That comes from West Africa. Yams. You know you got some yams on your Thanksgiving Day plate. Those come from West Africa. Cassava. All right. I think that is made into pone. Yes, made into pone. Rice. Okay. Pineapple. Okay. Maize, which is corn. Okay. We have connections here. Those foods traveled across the Atlantic. So we still have connection there, all right? You are not disconnected. We are not disconnected. I love the way Angelica puts it, I think quoting her, someone, that you can't, family can't hide. You can't, you cannot not be who you are. So it's better to spend time celebrating who you are than trying to hide who you are, because whoever you are is going to come out. Y'all not talking to me this afternoon. You understand? Just be who you are. You can't help. And that's why it's also, for me, kind of foolish and a fleshly, worldly thing for you to compete over how other people identify who you are. Just be who you are, and everybody else can deal with that. We are who we are, and we're worthy of celebrating. All right, language. This really connects with the Caribbean part, but there are some other languages that get shared. There's one I didn't put up here, but you may have heard in the video, Ashe. It is a Yoruba term, and it means may it be so. okay? That is used in a lot of West African cultures, but it's a Yoruba word, which is a part of Nigeria, all right? Now, there's some words that Caribbean folks will use that kind of ties us and links us to next week. From the Igbo language, the word Unu, if you ever talk with anybody who is Bayesian, there is a word that we would call is a cognizant in the South. You know how we say y'all? Okay, in Bayesian English, there is a word called wana. That comes from the Igbo Unu, okay? There's a direct connection there. Also, from the Igbo language, Bemu, Bemu. That means my place, my people. If you talk with folks who come from Barbados, they may refer to the country as Bem. That is a direct connection to a West African language. Culture travels. Culture travels. We are connected. We are connected. And then lastly here, a couple more things here, and then we'll wrap up this part. There are known African Americans who have traced their ancestry, like me, to Nigeria. Here are some of them. You have probably seen them. Forrest Whitaker, anybody know him? Famous actor. Nigerian heritage. Danny Glover, anybody know him? Nigerian heritage, right? We all love Die Hard. Glenda Hatchett, anybody know her? Judge, here in Atlanta. And Bishop T.D. Jakes, you should all know T.D. Jakes. And it's interesting, if you ever watch him, because he is a muse for me, sometimes he switches up his attire to wear traditional West African garb, because he's made a connection there. So it's wonderful when you can make connections and celebrate. All right, one last thing here on by West African story. We'll take a break for comments, questions, and then we'll move on to a North African story. And that is just about the modern Nigerian economy. It is a big oil-producing company. Some of the richest Black Africana people in the world come from Nigeria because of how much oil is produced. It's a big, big oil-producing company, and there are a lot of wealthy folks that come out of Nigeria for that reason. All right, so we finished this West African story today. Questions for those on campus and online, if somebody wants to come. We're going to have some questions for the whole group that Tabri is going to facilitate. But if there are any comments now, we can make room for those. And I'll stop talking for a minute. Pretty good. All right, very good. Let's go on now to our North African story. Next slide, please, for today. Shout out to the sound team. That graphic looks so great. All right. The North African story we'll share today is from Egypt. It is from Egypt. All right. I have a connection here because I've actually gone to Egypt. I have gone to Egypt. When I was a junior at Clark Atlanta University, I was blessed to study abroad at the American University in Cairo, Egypt. From August to December of 2009, it was an incredible experience. You can see I was smiling in that picture of the pyramids. It was hot, but I was having fun. Because I had a fascination with ancient Egyptian greatness, the wonder of the pyramids and the Sphinx, the things that you read about or you see on National Geographic, I wanted to go and explore. I wanted to go and experience. One of the things y'all will find about me if you don't already is that I love to travel. I love travel. Angelica and I, we travel together now, and we actually have travel that she'll share is kind of a part of our family. But I love to travel, and so I wanted to experience these things myself, okay? I also wanted to study Arabic, the Arabic language. I've studied or speak several different languages. That's Arabic that you can see there under the American University in Cairo, Al-Jama Al-Arabiya Bil-Qara, the American University in Cairo. And I wanted to learn that language. So I studied at Georgia Tech for a bit, and I studied when I was over there. And of course, if you know about the Bible at all, you can't help make connections with Egypt. We'll talk about some of those shortly with regard to Israel and with regard to early Christianity, okay? So this is the North African story I'll share today. Next slide, please. Egypt has a great heritage biblically, so let my people go is the refrain that we often hear and has translated into African-American culture and song, right, with spirituals and other references. And so in that way, Egypt really started for me being known as the land of the pharaohs. These were African kings who ruled for thousands of years, and ruled Egypt and built this great civilization, this great culture that you see when you go there. Pyramids, the Sphinx, the food, the Nile River. It's an amazing, amazing place if you can ever go and visit. And so these were kings, right? And so I was fascinated learning about all of these kings that ruled the dynasties there. And I also was fascinated because of the biblical connections, right? We know if you read the book of Exodus in scripture, that it was during the time of Pharaoh that Israel came down to Egypt through Joseph, right? That's how Israel first got to Egypt, is that God sent him ahead to make provision and redemption for his brothers. But when you get to the beginning of Exodus, one of the pharaohs sees that Joseph and Israel have become too powerful. You see, some people like you when you're not a threat to them, but as soon as they perceive you as a threat to them, they begin to be insecure, and then they try to take you out. But thanks be to God, we know the story that during that time, God sent a deliverer who was raised as an Egyptian, but he was actually a Hebrew in Moses, right? And we know that that began the story of Israel's deliverance from bondage during the Exodus. It's the greatest story of salvation in addition to the story of our Lord Jesus. All right, and if you ever have watched the movies, The Ten Commandments, or Prince of Egypt, you would have heard a name that some scholars think was the pharaoh during the time of the Exodus, and it was Ramesses, okay? So that's there. So again, there's this fascinating and amazing connection with Egypt from the Bible that we see and know that God brought Israel out. So it actually is appropriate to say that Israel as a nation was born in Africa. Because when you look at the Bible, it's cool to see around Exodus 11 and 12 that God, when God gets ready to bear Israel, that's the point that God gives Israel their calendar. So the Exodus is actually the beginning of the Jewish calendar, because God said this moment that you're about to be born and come out of bondage is when your new life begins. Hallelujah. I may have to come back to that another point. But the bottom line is that Israel was really born in Africa. And you know, the prophets say, out of Egypt I have called my son. So there's a really cool set of connections there. Okay, next slide. So there's also a connection, not just for Judaism, but with Christianity in Egypt, right? So the church in Egypt is a great, great source of inspiration. And again, the cool thing is, y'all, beyond today's presentation and our conversation, you can always go out to Google and YouTube and find out more. But for today, I do want to lift up the Coptic Orthodox Church. When I was in Egypt, I had the opportunity to go and see churches that were almost 2,000 years old. It was amazing. And these are Black Africana churches, right? These are churches that have been there for 1,000 years. So let's talk for a little bit about the church in Egypt. The Coptic church is one of the oldest churches in the world. It's been around for hundreds of years, right? And the church dates its history back to the Apostle John Mark, okay? John Mark is known as the gospel writer of the Gospel of Mark, okay? He was raised in Jerusalem, but he was really a disciple of Peter. And so some scholars would actually call Mark Peter's gospel, because he learned a lot of Jesus from Peter, okay? So, but with that, the Coptic tradition shares that just about a dozen years after Jesus' death and resurrection, Mark came to Egypt, that he came to Alexandria, which was known as a great and open city for learning in the ancient world. And that's where the gospel in Egypt began to be preached, okay? So this is, you know, just a century, just a few years, and then a century after Jesus, that the church takes its history, okay? Now, one of the cool things you'll see in the photos here that I think the Church of Egypt gives as a North African story is its art, okay? This art here goes back to the first few centuries after Jesus, and what do you all, this is a Coptic piece of art. This is Egyptian art here that depicts Jesus and the disciples. Does anybody notice anything about what Jesus and the disciples look like in this early Christian art? They have color, don't they? Okay. So they understood that there was a real connection with the people of God being a people who come from a place in the world that they have color, all right? So that's a real cool thing. So if you ever want to go online or Google or YouTube, just go online and check out Coptic art, right? There's some really cool things there. Also, you'll find there that along with Egypt, there is the Ethiopian Orthodox Church that has beautiful iconography. If you tuned in to sermons or presentations with us at Golden, that's where a lot of the Black Africana art that I get comes from. It comes from the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Again, in very, very early church, I took a class on Ethiopian Christianity from Howard University when I was in seminary. And if you have read Acts 8, you'll remember that there is the mention of an Ethiopian eunuch. Anybody heard of him? The Ethiopian church dates its founding back to that Ethiopian eunuch who, once he heard the gospel and was converted by Philip, came back to Ethiopia to serve the Kandake, which is not a name, it's a title that means queen, and that's how the Ethiopian church was born. And so again, you have two African countries who have been Christian for almost 2,000 years, all right? And we even see that in the book of Acts here. And how is it that we hear each of us in our own language, our own native language, residents of Egypt? And you also find Libya. So Christianity has been indigenous to Africa for thousands of years. Thousands of years. All right? It is also a place where Jesus and the Holy Family had come during the flight of Egypt. When you read Matthew's gospel, you find that because of Herod's insecurity, sound familiar? You got another king who is insecure and threatened by a child. So now he goes to try to exterminate a people, but God brings Jesus out. When they leave Israel, they go to Egypt. The reason that they can blend in is that they look like people who were from Egypt. Y'all not talking to me? All right. So this is the church in Egypt. The last thing I want to share is about being in Egypt, going to Mount Sinai. Next slide, please. Because Mount Sinai is that place where we remember that God meets us in the wilderness. God meets us in the wilderness. We know that Sinai, hallelujah, Sinai is an in-between place between Egypt and Canaan, right? So Sinai now is an in-between place between Egypt and Israel, okay? The picture there is me actually on top of a mountain that is known as Mount Sinai. It was a climb. I climbed to the top of the mountain. It gets so hot in Egypt that when we climbed, we had to make the climb at night. And y'all, it was a very, very physically strenuous thing. But if you're adventurous and you want to travel there to climb it, it's worth it. And so you travel there at night, and you even could get on camels because camels were traveling around the mountain. You literally go around the mountain and you come out at the top and you see the sunrise. It was amazing. It was so beautiful. So with that, again, Sinai is where we see God's people meet God there. God revealed the law to Moses at Sinai. God took Moses to the tent of meeting on Sinai because we all need a tent where we meet with God. Elijah is where God met. Met God at Sinai. When he was afraid, God said, "You got to go back to Sinai." Okay? It is a real place, and it's beautiful, and it's amazing. All right. So as I wrap up here, being in Egypt was really a spiritual pilgrimage for me. It was obviously a rich place culturally, but spiritually, to know that you're in the place that some of these events happen was very, very holy. And I could go on, and maybe at another time I could show you pictures where we were on the Nile River. The Nile River today is a bustling place because you have in downtown Cairo restaurants, businesses that are right on the Nile. You can eat there and look out and see the river, and it's beautiful. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. So we're going to get ready to wrap up, and then we'll have time to talk together, and we'll come and sit down with you. When I was in seminary, our church history professor, y'all can see that I love history. I love history. But one of our church history professors would ask us at the end of every class, so what, right? Like, again, history matters to the degree that we can extrapolate significance, that we can draw out meaning from the story. So, next slide, please. Here's the so what. Again, our celebration talks at Golden this year are designed to help us understand the power of the stories that we tell ourselves about ourselves. Amen? So, with the West African stories, here's one I want to share as a significance. From our West African lineage and diaspora stories. Our West African stories remind us that our ancestors of old and we today come from greatness. And it's not simply a kind of Marvel comic Wakanda greatness. These are actual places. These are actual people that we come from and our culture comes from. So that we have great civilizations and kingdoms of great accomplishment that we come from. Culture and commerce and food. And again, for me, learning this as a child, I knew spiritually as a Christian, as a child of God, that I had access, that I was the head and not the tail. But then to see images of people who had done these things meant that there was no way I was going to settle for anything less than God had, because I knew if I saw that they could do it, that I could do it too. Does that make sense? So it's so important that we tell ourselves positive, empowering stories about what's possible for us. Secondly, and this is important, that neither our origin nor our destiny as Africana or African diasporan people in the Americas is pain and bondage. Now, if the only stories you've been told about where you come from are pain and bondage, that's not the fullness of your story. And it is very concerning to me when people have access to stories that are beginning in pain. That's not where we come from. That's not where you come from. And if you have access to these stories, you'll know that you come from greatness. You know that you come, and you can point to it. And you can root yourself into it. And it will be, again, a quarry of gold for you. And a quarry of inspiration with you, so you don't have to let your environment tell you about what's possible or not for you. But you have to have access to your stories. So our destiny, neither our origin, is as people of pain. We had painful experiences to get here, but that's not where we come from, neither is it where we're called to go. And lastly, we have rich treasures that we have brought to the West. In our food and in our language and in our culture. And again, we can't help be who you are. So let your light shine. Let your light shine. All right, let's talk secondly, and I'll close, around our North African story. So what? So what? So what? Next slide, please. Again, the power of the stories we tell ourselves about ourselves. North African stories remind us first that Christianity was in North Africa before it was in much of Europe. So don't you let people tell you that you got Christianity by somebody treating you as less than a human being. That is not the story. That's not the story. Christianity was in North Africa before it got to much of Europe. We've been Christians as people for thousands of years. Thousands of years. So African and Black diasporan exposure to Jesus and Christianity did not first come from transatlantic slavery. That is not where our faith in God came from. And the reason this is important, I was talking to one of our young adults the other day, is that there is a spiritual kind of pagan temptation that is sweeping our Black communities right now that is built under the false assumption that our exposure to Christianity first happened from somebody treating us as less than human beings. And it's just not true. So, this is an Ethiopian icon here. And it is, again, a beautiful source of art. Just Google Ethiopian Orthodox Church if you want to find one. All right, so that is the conclusion of my part of our first celebration talk. Hope you found something meaningful today. All right, let's talk together. And I'm gonna ask Bree, if you can come down and we'll just talk with our folks today. If there are any questions or comments that we want to add, and then we're going to have some yummy West African food we're going to eat. All right? So if you have questions, comments, let's start here, and then Bree can kind of come up and just help. If there are any questions you think that folks may be interested to ask or may be shy about asking, but we've got both mics on, so let's just start conversation. Let's start our talk today, all right? So, want to start up here, or should we start with the audience first? What do you think? Okay, cool. All right, do we have any questions or comments from the audience today? Would love to hear feedback. Yeah, hold on, just come to the mic because we got folks streaming. Thank you. Because we got folk online. Yes. We got folk online. Hold on, come to the mic. Thank you.
If you go back to the previous slide that you had here with the Ethiopian art, in that picture, I don't think it's that one, babe. In that picture, this one.
Yes.
Is it showing Jesus as an Ethiopian, or is it showing him as a European?
Yeah, that is Jesus in Ethiopian skin there. So, yeah, so again, that's the power of that art, is mm-hmm. the power of depicting Christ in images that look like us. Yes.
So how have we moved from him to all these other different nationalities?
It's a great question. So I'm going to give this back because I've got this here. Part of what has happened in how the kind of worldly, sinful way that colonialism collided with Christianity is that there was this general cultural whitewashing of Christianity. That is in the stories, in the art, because what was trying to be enforced in that was something that just was not historically true. Was that Jesus and the Hebrews and the people of God did not have color. We just know that that's not the truth. But unfortunately, if people are not educated and taught the truth of Scripture, investigate it, or have it available to them, they'll just kind of believe whatever's going on. And so that's what happened. You know, there was a very dangerous colliding between power and white supremacy and colonialism that Western churches brought when they came to West Africa or when they came to this country. And that desire to elevate some people above other people, certainly white Europeans, became collided with that depiction of art. But as we have thoroughly discussed today, that's not the truth, both biblically and historically. So hopefully you'll take what you've learned and have an informed and rooted opinion historically and biblically and be able to share it with other people. Great question. Other questions, comments? Yeah, please come on up. Oh, yep, because we got people online and we need to hear. I'll make sure that yeah.
This is basically wanting to know your thoughts.
Okay.
Based on what Florida is trying to do with history and our history.
Yeah.
And they focus, I guess the books really focus on slavery and that type of thing. Mm-hmm. So what's your thought on certain statehoods are wanting to remove just basic history that our children and what we are known for in the United States.
Yeah.
But bringing this out as far as educational purposes is a wonderful thing, but I want to know your thoughts on what Florida is trying to do with history.
Yeah, thanks for that, Carolyn. I'll start by answering this way. Again, part of the focus of this celebration, I'm coming to your question, is the importance and power that we have as members of our communities and our own communities of telling our stories ourselves. So I think on one hand is recognizing that regardless of what civic school systems are doing between our churches and our own kind of communal organizations, we are responsible for making sure that our kids and our communities know our stories. So that's number one. I think to get to your question, part of what's happening in Florida and in other places is that America as a country is browning. America is on a course of moving to being a minority-majority country, I think by 2045. And there are people who are of European-American descent who see that diversifying as a threat to their one-sided view of history. And so I think that, just like we were dealing with Egypt and Pharaoh, there is a similar effort to culturally wash certain people out of the stories so that we don't have access to the strength and the inspiration of who we really are. And that's not a new thing, but it's a fresh expression. But this has been going on. But we counter that, I think, not only by being civically involved in choosing leaders for government, but also by making sure that regardless as to who or in out of office, that our churches and our families tell our own stories. You don't have to wait for civic leaders for you to take authority to tell your kids what the truth is. We don't have to wait for who is in office or who gets elected at the end of the year for us to decide that we're going to tell our communities our own story. So I want to encourage everybody in your agency and self-control to tell your story, full stories about yourselves. But that's what's going on there. Questions? Do you have anything that you want to add or ask? Because I know you'll be kind of helping to facilitate us.
No, I will say if you all do plan on coming out to the rest of our Celebration Talk series, we have flyers on the table in the fellowship hall. So if you're able to see the topic or the theme for a specific Saturday, you may want to do, and I don't want to call it research, but do some type of something so that, you know, you can have questions. Because I know for my Saturday, we'll have some county and city elected officials. And so I want that time to be beneficial because I'll give them questions regarding the theme. But I want the church to use that opportunity as a time to ask questions, to host a conversation with them about real topics, not a campaign, you know, speech or nothing like that, but the real topics, like what Ms. Newsom said, you know, what are we doing to make sure that our school system will keep a curriculum that's conducive to having great citizens, you know, making sure our teenagers can go out into the workplace with knowledge. Yes. So, yeah, I would just advise, you know, for each topic or each Saturday, look into the theme and kind of get some questions prepared for our panel.
Great. Thank you, Bree. Any other comments, questions? Otherwise, yeah, please go on. Please. No, we really want you to ask questions and have comments because this is a conversation with our talk. All
okay.
Right? Yeah.
This is not really a question.
Okay.
But I want to bring a point.
Okay.
I, too, went to a high school in Brewton, Alabama, which the school was a school that was sponsored by the Reformed Church of America.
Okay.
It was originated and it was founded by a slave. His name was James Dooley. The school housed kids from all over the United States.
Wow.
And this is in Brewton, Alabama.
Yeah.
They came from California, Chicago, Detroit. They had dormitories in my city, in my town, and they taught educating students hand, heart, and hands.
Yes.
When you talk about history and you talk about our experiences and what people don't know, that this school, it didn't, in a, I guess, the last 20 years, 15 years, they wanted the school to be independent of the Reformed Church of America. So what happened was the funding stopped.
Oh my.
And the school is still located. Property is still there, but it disintegrated because we as a people did not support the school. And well-known people, Lionel Rich's wife, mother taught at this school.
Wow.
Joe Lee, which is a Alabama state president, came out of this school. But it's well known for people all over the world. Yeah. And it's called Southern Normal.
Southern Normal.
Southern Normal. So
I may have had a relative that went there.
Yeah.
You may have to talk.
So if anybody want to do some research,
yeah,
look up Southern Normal School in Brewton, Alabama.
Great.
Historical black institution.
Thank you for that. You just inspired something in my spirit, Carolyn. And Bree, maybe this is something that we can work on at Black History Team. It may be cool if we could use the doc that we have for our Q&A, maybe kind of as a ongoing resource list as we have things that people want to share. So if you all will email us, email the church or email me, you have some things that you either feel will be inspiring to add to our stories, things we want to investigate or have people share, we can add that maybe. Because the QR code that's on your Black History flyer, it goes to a doc, and it's a Google Doc, so we can upload things to it. So yeah, shoot that to us, and we can add that for research, inspiration, and other things that we want us to look up. Okay, good. Awesome. This is so great. Any last thoughts or reflections? Otherwise, we'll wrap up, give you a preview of next week and a bless of food, and we'll be done. Yep.
Pastor Bria, yes. Miss Bria, how do we, as a black race, when we came over, our mindsets changed to be separate and to tell the massa what our family was doing, what was going on in the community. Mm-hmm. How do we as a community now bring our people back together without and to destroy the separation? Because our mindset is, some of our mindset is, as long as we're telling what's going on, then it's like a plus for the other races. But how do we as a people bring ourselves and our strengths and our history back together as one?
That's good. That's a multi-part question. But here's what I'll say as a short answer. I'm actually writing a book dealing with something related to this. More Than Enough. Y'all pray for your pastor as we work on that. But here's what I have discovered is a transcendent fleshly experience as human beings, because it gets to your question. And it is a scarcity thinking mentality, a thinking mentality that's rooted in scarcity. That is, for people who are of the flesh, when somebody else has, that threatens my having. But until there can be a spiritual transformation. So Paul says, do not be conformed to the world, that's scarcity, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that's abundance. So in an abundance mentality, your having doesn't threaten my having, and my having doesn't threaten your having. But until our mind is renewed, somebody else's success becomes a threat to us. Now that's in between a community, Black Africana communities, but it's also in between other communities. Until everybody's mind becomes renewed, people are still going to see other people as a threat. Again, that is within a group and that is between groups. That takes a renewal of mind. And for me as a Christian, the ultimate real renewal of the mind only comes through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Spiritually, we have to become a new people with a new mind and a new thinking. Until that happens, it doesn't matter how much legislation is drafted. It doesn't matter how much people learn. Until their mind is taken over with the mind of Christ, you're going to keep getting the same results. So people's minds have to be renewed. People's minds have to be renewed. Otherwise, it's all still flesh. It's all still flesh, and it's all still competing over stuff. Competing over status, competing over popularity, competing over land, competing over money. It's a flesh versus spirit type of thing. So the flesh will fool you to think that it's about something else, but it's not. It's not. And until we deal at that level, you keep getting the same results. So when I tell y'all, invite people to church, we're inviting their minds to be renewed.
Yes.
We're inviting their families to be renewed.
Yes.
We're inviting the leaders when they come here to be renewed.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Y'all got me happy this afternoon.
I just got one comment.
Please, 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 yeah.
I like when you said the mindset.
Yes.
Because I was reading in our devotional and it was talking about, and you preached about it, you spoke about it, the mindset.
Yes.
When we reset the mind,
yes,
then everything else will come into, it'll just fall into place.
Yes.
So we have to reset the mind of our young people,
yes,
of our children,
yes,
because our communities was what kept everything in line for us.
Yeah, yeah.
And so we were rich in businesses and banks and housing and community,
yeah,
because the mindset said,
you
can do this.
You can do it.
This is yours. You don't have to ask anybody for it. So as,
yes,
far as teaching the history, our history, it's a mindset we got to start at home,
yes,
and work our way out into the community.
That's good.
And a lot of people don't understand that the news, the publications, the things out there feeds into the brain if,
absolutely,
the mindset isn't where it needs to be.
Absolutely.
And that's what I love that
you
mindset.
You got it. So again, my prayer with that, as we get ready to go, is that we will invite some more people to these talks, that you will invite some our children and our students to these talks. We need to see some young people in here. I know Uriah just couldn't make it, but he'll be here. But we need some more kids because we are responsible. And as you got it, Teresa, once we tell our stories, the mind can be renewed. The mind can be open. The possibilities. Again, that's why I'm so passionate about having these talks this year, because I saw these stories. I learned these stories. So there has never been a limit for me about what could be possible, because I had stories of kings and queens and leaders. It was all open. And that's what we've got to get in our minds at a young age and at an old age. There's no ceiling. There's no ceiling. But we have to tell our stories. The stories we tell ourselves about ourselves,
yes,
have to be positive,
yes,
and enriching and without limit.
Amen.
And when we do, we can really celebrate. Amen? Amen. All right. Thank y'all so much. Y'all, is this helpful today?
That's good.
Great. Okay, last slide, and then we'll pray. We'll be dismissed for food, and then we'll see you next week. I think we've got the slide up there about the next week. We're going to give you a tease and give you a preview for next week. The Caribbean is going to be presented by my beloved with Mrs. Jelica Harper King. So please come out on campus. Please come out online. We're going to have a great time. We may have some surprises for you too. But thank y'all for coming out for this first celebration talk. Good?
Good,
good, good. All right, let's bless the food, and then Pastor, if there are any instructions, we'll go and get those in. But God, we're so grateful for this day. We're grateful for the gift of your presence among us as we celebrate our stories. As God, we look to the rock from which we are hewn, that God, we can rediscover that we come from greatness, we come from love, we come from blessing, we come from grace, not only spiritually, but culturally. So God, help us to take what we've learned today, and God, may it be food that transforms how we see ourselves and the stories that we tell ourselves about ourselves, so that God, we can go for it as salt and light into the world. We can't thank you, God, for this wonderful West African food that has been prepared for us. We pray that, God, you would bless it and those prepared it, that we may be nourished to do your will. These things we all ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank y'all so much.
I've been waiting all my life. I've been spending all my nights contemplating all my trials. Oh my God, this not overnight. I've been giving all my soul. I've been chasing all my goals. Dedication, all I know. That's how hard I go. Blood, sweat, and my tears. No, I will not surrender. If you take my lead, then we can fly together. Heaven never seemed to reach us now or never. We got what we need, but we don't got forever.